We will do this problem of oscillation of mass, where is it? It is connected to mass, to a Planck of a negligible mass, and we have to find the oscillations. I'll tell you the speed method of doing it, and I'll also tell you the detailed derivation because that is equally important. Speed method is applicable when the mass is zero. Important. If this mass is given as negligible, then apply the speed method. And speed method is very simple. Just redraw the diagram. This is K1, this is M, this is K2. Up till here it's easy. Suppose this is the problem, you can easily do it. Suppose this was the problem, what you do? These two are taken as parallel. So K equivalent is K1 plus K2. Very simple. And omega is K equivalent upon M. Please note, if they are on opposite side, they are added. It is not a series. This much you can do. Now, make it slightly difficult. Suppose I add K3 here. This also you can do. Here, K equivalent will be what? Here, K equivalent will be just down below will be 1 upon K2 plus 1 upon K3. And then your final K will be K equivalent plus K1. And your omega will be K final upon M. Easy. Now, I want to convert this problem in this easy form. Only thing is, instead of K3, here you have to multiply it by a factor which is square of this divided by square of this. B square upon A square. Suppose there are more springs here, up or down, wherever, don't mind. Keep on adding those springs, multiplying by this factor means square of their distance divided by square of this distance of this mass. Square of their distance divided by square of the distance of this mass. And you can keep on adding. Let me solve this one only first. So here your K equivalent down below. This K equivalent will be how much? Is 1 upon K2 plus 1 upon K3. B square over A square, and you get K3 B square plus K2 A square upon K2 K3 B square is your 1 upon K equivalent. So your K final is K equivalent plus K1, which is K1 plus K2 K3 B square upon K3 B square plus K2 A square, and your omega will be simply K1 plus K2 K3 B square upon K3 B square plus K2 A square divide by M. This is your answer. You can note. Now I'll do the same thing by the detailed method. Detailed method also one should know. And if you add more springs, you can keep on adding it. Only thing is this will become more and more complex. Now, why this has come? Just try to see the logic behind this speed method. I repeat, it is applicable only if this mass is zero. Don't do it otherwise. I repeat, only if this mass is zero, apply the speed method. Otherwise, don't do that. Now, whenever it is given that mass is zero, net force on that body has to be taken as zero, and net torque on that body also has to be taken as zero. If you see what is torque net is I alpha, if mass is zero, I is zero, torque net has to be zero. So the net torque in this rod has to be zero. Means whatever torque this spring will give, same torque should be given by this point. And important thing is when you deal with springs attached here and there, always look at their points. Force given by this point will be, if there is a spring, look at the point in the spring. It will give the force which will be equal to K times this into plus minus delta, whatever, compression or extension, whatever. And this is given equally on both the sides because the mass of the spring is taken as zero. So just look at the points of the spring and extension and compression in the spring. That's done. Look at nothing else. Now, when we come here, let us assume that this Planck moves down by an angle theta. So it comes like this. So what is the compression here is b theta, and distance traveled here is a theta. Suppose this mass, this is the fixed frame, this is upper spring, and this is mass m. Let it move by distance delta, and this is the lower spring. The lower spring, lower point of the spring moves by b theta, a theta, sorry. It moves by a theta. So you have a spring whose upper thing moves by delta and lower thing moves by a delta, and these are all absolute distances. A theta is in terms of this fixed point, this delta is in this. These distances have to be from the same reference point, absolute or whatever, they should not be different. Then they have to be subtracted from each other. If they both are equal, then the net effect is zero. And you will subtract which one from which one, that you have to see depending on the situation. Here, this spring is providing you the compression, the torque is upwards. So this spring should also provide you torque downwards, only then the net torque will be zero. How this spring will provide the force downwards? It will provide the force downwards only when it is compressed. And how it will be compressed? When delta is greater than a delta. Delta is compressing this spring, a delta is stretching this spring. If I look at it, depends from which side you are looking at it. If you look at it from this side, then delta is compressing. If you look at from this side, then a delta is extending. So let me take delta greater than a delta, means this spring is having net compression. So the force exerted by this spring will be delta minus a theta, this is a theta, sorry, a theta. Delta minus a theta is the force given by this spring on this, and the torque will be a times. So this torque has to match with this torque. This torque is k3b theta. K3b theta is the distance, into b gives you the moment. So this equation I have got. So you can write as, and this is k2 times. This has to match. So k2 delta a is equal to theta k2 a square plus k3 b square. So your theta is, or let me write a theta, if I multiply by a theta, is k2 a square upon k2 a square plus k3 b square. This is what is the value of a theta. Now when I am dealing with this spring, if it is compressed, it is providing the force downwards on this, and it is acting upwards on this by the force which is k2 delta minus a theta, is the force which is provided by this spring. Look at only the end of this spring. And what is delta minus a theta? Delta minus a theta will be delta minus a theta. And a theta is equal to k2 delta, sorry, delta is also there, k2 delta, delta a square upon k2 a square plus k3 b square. So it becomes k3 delta b square upon k2 a square plus k3 b square is your delta minus a theta. And what is k2 delta minus a theta is this much. So you, the force here which is coming is k2 k3 delta b square upon k2 a square plus k3 b square. What is the force due to this spring? This is also, that's this, I had taken this as stretching, it is coming downward. This is being compressed, is a different matter, but this spring is stretched because delta is downwards, so it is k1 into delta. So the net force acting on it in the upward direction, which is opposing its acceleration, this m delta double dot is equal to minus, what is the net force? K1 delta plus delta K2 K3 B square upon K2 A square plus K3 B square. Just take delta outside, minus delta and delta. What is this? This is nothing but your simple harmonic motion equation where this is the equivalent K. So omega will be equal to K1 plus K2 K3 B square upon K2 A square plus K3 B square upon M. Now this should match with my speed method thing. So let me write the speed method again. I have rubbed it. I don't remember it. So speed method, what was there? It was K1 here, K2 here, and K3 into multiplied by this factor B square by A square. So my this K equivalent, K1 upon K equivalent is 1 upon K2 plus 1 upon K3 B square A square. So it is K3 B square plus K2 A square upon K2 K3 B square, 1 upon K equivalent. So K equivalent was equal to K2 K3 B square upon K3 B square plus K2 A square. What is your net K? Because these two are now in parallel, this K equivalent and K1 are in parallel, so they will add. So K final is K1 plus K2 K3 B square upon K3 B square plus K2 A square, which should match with this part, and it is matching. K1 K2 K3 B square K3 B square plus K2 A square, yes, right? So the speed method gives you the same result, which the detailed method takes a lot of time. And simply, if there is one more spring here, you can accordingly add another spring in series with that factor.